Right now, we're in quote unquote off season, which is kind of a joke. Still running at 75 pounds a week. But I guess the key of the day for me is I wake up at like 7 and I eat some breakfast at home, and then we have. Sorry?
3 weeks.
Oh, okay, I need to make breakfast. Sometimes avocados are the new thing. And I usually go to Nike most days. We have Nike World Headquarters. I'm looking forward to some Nike World Headquarters is there. And we have a track, and we have some running trails, and pretty much any day, if you want to have a workout, just have a long run. Pretty much any day, if you want to run with people, if you show up to Nike around 9 a.m., there's going to be people for your run. We have 8 girls on our team and about 12 guys. And the girls, our marathoners especially, they are like much renowned, so they will be there. Every morning, they start at like 8:45, but I usually get there about 9 and meet up with them because they're going to run like longer than me anyway, so I'll always get a head start. So yeah, I get there around 9 and then we do a run, and then after the run, sometimes we get in the pool right away to do a little extra cross training, and then go to lunch, and I usually have lunch at home. Sometimes I have lunch at Kenny's. And then, so that's like Monday, Wednesday, Friday. In the afternoon at 2, we meet for weights and core, which is with a different coach. He's like a strength coach. And that usually lasts for about an hour. Sometimes after that, I go to a physical therapy appointment or get a sports massage, not like a nice massage. So, and then, pretty much after that, I sometimes people do something fun after, but I usually just like poop and then like, eat dinner for the bed. then if we have a workout, it's instead of going for a run, you just go and meet coach in the morning for a workout, and then sometimes take a nap in the afternoon on those days. I guess that's kind of it. That's like my normal schedule. We have 3 workouts a week usually. The 3rd workout is the long run usually. So the other days are just like kind of easy Mondays.
You practice with hurdles?
Not in the fall, so in the spring we do. This spring was weird, but I think this year I would probably start doing hurdles even in the indoor season, even though there's some steeplechase on the track. But I'll probably do some hurdles in the spring, in early March maybe, but not anything over hurdles in the workout until April probably. It's a good question actually. In college, we would do anywhere from like 11 to 13 miles. This fall, or like last fall when I joined the team, and it was frustrating. The girls were doing anywhere from 14 to like 20 miles, depending on their events. Some times we go a little longer, 10K was a little longer, or like 15 for the girl, probably it's not going to do a 20 mile. But even our group does distance, so even if you're running 1500 or a steeplechase, which is like a shorter distance event, you're still probably going to push to like 15 to 18 miles as a long run. But I have yet to do that because, just been injured. So this fall, the longest long run I've done so far is 13. And so next week, we're probably going to start having to bump that up before my legs are daily. Any distance events, but we have a prelim and final. So the only distance event that is a straight final is a 10K. We don't make the 10K run. Runners do it twice. That'd be pretty brutal. But as a 5K runner, you have to run a prelim and a final of 5K. For an 800, you have to run 3 800s. So 3 different days of running. And I had one prelim and then the final. So it makes it hard to double up because if you just had to run it once and you got a couple days, then you got to run a different event, that'd be easier, but it's pretty impossible, not to mention the whole interest qualifying to this. I think if anything later down the road I might have to move up to the 5K once I get too old to jump over stuff. But I wouldn't move actually bigger than that in Portland called Forest Park, and it's actually cooler than our Forest Park. You can see. They have some really cool like single track trails, which just you get lost in the woods out there. You can just run for miles and not see. Well, sometimes you see like a hiker or whatever, but it's pretty quiet and you're just kind of in the woods. And so that's it. Yeah, probably my favorite place to, especially for like a recovery run. You kind of just need like to run slow and kind of like be alone and don't want to talk. But to go out there and just like kind of meditate with them. Yeah. Sometimes I do it from running alone. I have an iPod shuffle that like clips onto your shirt, and so I'll use that if I'm running alone. But I typically run with my team. We just talk, and it makes the time go by faster. But if I'm like swimming, super boring, my iPad is waterproof, so I have little waterproof headphones. Mostly over music, I listen to podcasts. It kind of like tells me a story while I'm going and distracts me. Yeah.
Will you tell us about your mile repeat workouts?
Yeah.
From coach.
This fall, I missed them all last year, but this fall we've been doing these workouts called just mile repeats on a field at Nike. And it's 3 laps to a mile on this field, and we wear spiked flats, so they're kind of like racing flats, but Nike makes them special for us because it's kind of slippery out there, and so that's, they build spikes into them for us. And basically, we do like a mile around there, 3 laps to a mile, and then you get 90 seconds recovery, and you go again, and 90 seconds recovery, and you go again, and then you go again. We've been doing them lately. I'm going to forget. So my last one, I did 8 miles, which was my workout PR. My workout record is 8 of them before I was doing 7 of them. Sometimes we do 2 miles and then the rest. But this one was just 8 times a mile, and we started out at like 5:25, 5:27 pace, and then we squeezed it down at the end to like 5:19, 5:20-ish pace, still with 90 seconds recovery in each one. So you just get basically enough time to like switch out your mouth with water and sort of catch your breath and you go again. But we take turns on the lead, so we have 7 girls out there, we take a big long train, just one after another. And if you're at the front, then you go circle around to the next one, you're going to be the last, which is like the worst spot to be, so you have to follow. Hard to see. So you go through the line, you have a victory meeting, and pretty much how it goes. And crank out like 7 or 8 of those. Marathon girls do 10. It's like, couldn't do it. I was toasted after 8, so I can't imagine if I'm going to be 2 more. It's tough for guys. I like to grab, I call my dad a grab, I don't know if that's what I'm just calling the girls. Yeah. Awesome question. So she said, how did nutrition and, did you say just nutrition?
Training.
Training and nutrition. Yeah, I actually, I majored in dietetics, which is like nutrition science. I have a passion for it, and I really think that it plays a huge part in an athlete's experience and an athlete's success. But even people who don't study it or choose it as like a specialty, I think a lot of athletes would say that when they eat better and they eat good foods that are not processed, they don't come out of a box or can, they're not in the freezer that you put in the microwave, and they're not you can't drive through somewhere to get it, that it makes them feel better, and they feel better when they're doing better workouts, and they just feel like clean and they have more energy, and their workouts, they don't get fatigued as quickly.